why big data? These are some of the quotes that we probably have heard over and over again. In God we trust, all others bring data. Without data, you are just a person with opinion. We all can have whatever opinion we want. But the latest I've heard is Jeff Jonas, when IBMers, says, let the data speak. The data will have all this factual information. Why are we here today? To talk about big data. But because it's a big data in education. Well, why? That is, it's because there is a big, huge shortage in big data professionals. This is the statistics from iCrunch data, and it says that by the year, this is about 2 years ago now, by the year 2017, which is right now, big data will create about 4.4 million tech jobs globally, out of which 1.9 million will be in the US. Now, the numbers tells us that we are in a huge shortage of technological skilled talented people here. Another piece of information from business.com here. The International Data Corporation says it predicts that by next year, we need about 181,000 people with deep analytic skills. But from there, we need about 5 times that number to do data management and interpretation skills. So as we can see here, there is a huge need for big data analysts. Not only because of that, but they will spun off a lot of other jobs as well. And we are in huge demand for data scientists or data-related jobs there. This is another piece of information from Simon Fraser University in Canada, who offers big data courses at a master's level as well. In North America, in Canada, they predict that they need about 19,000 people in big data. In the US, 190,000. If we look at these numbers here, and some of the numbers that Richard presented earlier on, they are almost in the same ballpark figure, and they're very consistent. So we know there's a huge shortage of data scientists. What are they worth? This chart here shows the range of average salary for the different related fields. And the numbers that are quoted up here are excluding their stocks and bonuses. This is sorted in descending order, and as you can see here, data scientists command the widest range of, or the highest range of, salary scaling. In the past, I used to look at, okay, which is the most well-paid job? Well, that is one measure of how a profession is being remunerated. But there is actually another component to it as well, which is the expected rise in each of them. So not only that we're talking about the salary for the particular group of profession, but the annual pay rise as well. So this is this column here is the one that strikes me as that this is another piece of information which I've never looked at, because most of us would have just looked at this column over here. Now, interestingly, 2 years ago, when I attended the Big Data, or 3 years ago now, the Big Data AdCon conference in Vegas, came across this data scientist who runs his own big data company in the San Francisco Bay Area. And he was telling me that, or us at that time, that there was a potential candidate who's from the Midwest. And in the Midwest at that time, the starting pay was about 120K. But when he was being interviewed in San Francisco Bay Area, he likes that guy because he can do what he wants. And immediately, he topped his salary up by 20K, just on the spot. And we were asking, the spot, he knew that he would have been picked up by somebody else just like that. This is how demand it is in the big data world. We are in huge shortage of data scientists. But that's just the basic. What is the added value in there? The boost in the worth of what they are worth? Well, Robert Half.com here says that if you have additional skills to it, you expect to have these additional increase as well. So not only that, big data scientists commands a huge salary with bigger annual pay rise expected, but if you have got these added value skills, you get more too. This is how attractive it is if you want to look at the remuneration part of it. So prior to this slide here, we talked about why there is a shortage of it and why is there the demand for it and the remuneration. The focus of my presentation here is to talk about why the need for big data in the K-12 program. Preparation pipeline for K-12 in the job market. Industry is over here. We know we're in huge demand for big data scientists. Colleges, universities are preparing them to their master's program, PhD program. There are quite a lot of them out there already. And undergraduate, they're beginning to offer them. Let's do a reality check on it. As I've just mentioned, a lot of universities are offering big data related courses. Undergraduate, they are cropping up now. What about at K-12? Why do we need to focus on the K-12? Graduate schools are not cranking them fast enough to meet this demand. That's why the undergraduate colleges, universities, are trying to feed it through the master's program. But what we need as educators, we need to actually start focusing in the K-12. Because these are the people who are going to be feeding through the pipeline. Being educators, lecturers, professors here, you know it takes time to actually train or teach the students the concept and the work to be able to produce work there. But if we can start teaching them or exposing them to big data at an earlier age, we can actually solve this problem quicker. It's not about just doing it at this point. We need to have longer vision to prepare big data scientists. So, how did it all begin? What I'm going to talk about here is to give you an account of the chronological report of how big data was being delivered at Concordia International School. It started out in about 2013, 4 years ago. I've got a quote here from Tim LeBlanc. We humans crave knowledge. When that craving ends, we are no longer human. We are always striving for information. It was interesting yesterday, one of my students asked me and said, how did you get into big data? Big data is very new. And a bit about myself here, just so that we understand it in context. I did not start out as a high school teacher. My background is actually in engineering. My undergrad is in electrical, my master's is in mechanical, and my PhD is in aerospace. I dabble in a lot of fields. I have a lot of interest in many other things as well. So when my student asked me, what brought you this interest, and I love numbers. I collect data numbers for the sake of collecting it. And I was as I was telling one of each time I travel, I'll be having this humidity checker on my hand. And what I do is, I measure the humidity in for all my in-flights. And with that, I found an app on the smartphone that actually records the decibel level as well. So on each long-haul flight, in fact, every flight that I do, I'll measure the humidity level, the decibel, and I'll take a picture of that along with my boarding pass for every flight. And what I found was that the average depth sound level in flight is about 84, 85 decibels. Yeah. And what brought that to me? It started when my two children were at age 1 and 2. We have friends who said that, why would you let your child travel so much when they're just infant? The question is, what is the long-term effect of loud sound exposure to an infant? And I was like, what do you mean by loud sound? They said, in the airplane, 85 decibels is about the sound of a busy street. What is the long-term exposure to that to an infant? By long-term exposure, I mean 6-7 hours continuously. I don't know. I don't have the answer yet. So it prompted me to start recording the data, the sound level in flight. And then the humidity, we thought, well, what's a comfortable humidity level? And with that one, how it brought about was that when my children were young, bring them to theme parks in the US, the summer over there could be about 36, 39 degrees, and yet people are willing to line up in the hot sun for 40 minutes to about 120 minutes or so. And theme parks are actually cropping up in Southeast Asia as well, which is a much more humid environment. So the curiosity came to me that would people actually line up for 100 minutes out in the hot, humid weather as well? I don't know what it means by to be humid. And that's when I got my humidity checker, and I'll be checking that every once in a while to see what the humidity level is in Florida on a typical hot summer day compared to the ones in, say, in Singapore or Malaysia. In flight, what I found was that the driest that you can get during those 13 hours long haul flight from Asia to North America is it can drop as low as to 7%. That's how dry it is. For those of us who fly, who travel, and if you were to wear contact lenses, you'll know that you do not want to be wearing contact lenses during those long haul flights. So these are some of the personal interests that I had, like human grade knowledge. So what happened was that in 2013, I was having a parent-teacher conference with a student. Now, our school is very advanced for a private international school. We offer multivariable and linear algebra at a high school level. And these two courses are actually courses by Concordia University, Portland. These are second year multivariable and linear algebra courses. So this is just to put you in context about the caliber of our students. And there's no reason why that during a parent-teacher conference meeting, the parent, the student was saying, so what other math courses are there that we can take beyond the multivariable and linear algebra? And then the idea or the word data mining, big data came up. I thought I'll pick this picture over here. Black and white TVs. Some of us can relate to it very well, with the dial knobs as well. As information is growing, but we humans continuously want more. We are hunger for knowledge. So there was an interest from the student. I'm interested in it. We pitched the idea to the principal, and I was was expecting him to say, no, we can't do it. But instead, his response was, why not? Why aren't we doing it? So with the encouragement from the principal, I said, well, there isn't such a course in the world yet, let alone resources. There are no textbooks or big data textbooks at K-12 level. I'm not actually sure if there is one even at undergraduate level, other than just the different modules on specific softwares. So we did have a problem at that point. We had a hurdle to jump over. Teaching resources. There is nothing out there. So we were looking through the net, we were trying to find out information. There was absolutely nothing, no big data material specifically for high school. Until we came about that one book. But is that the best way to actually teach a course? Do we need to have a textbook of materials that's already been catered, programmed, and all packaged for a particular course? The answer is no. How did those established courses such as biology, chemistry, physics, calculus, algebra exist? Going back 200, 300 years ago, did those courses exist before the need for it? I don't think so. I think it was actually objective driven. We needed to reach some objective here, and we human beings decided that, oh, we need to know this to get over here. And after a period of time, we realized that, hey, we can actually start categorizing these courses and call them biology, chemistry, physics, algebra, pre-cal, finite mathematics, statistics. But that is because we knew that there is an objective that needs to be reached. So with this in mind, we do what we call, well, in engineering terms, is understanding by reverse engineering, backward design. We started with students going into internships. So we actually had an internship program at that time that's related to big data. We had about 6 or 7 of our students doing internship with IBM in Shanghai. And from there, we worked backwards as to what do we need to teach the students to reach them? Because there are no material out here. It's a blank slate, but we know what our objectives are. We had to work backwards. So the fact that we did not have, or there isn't a textbook that is catered for the K-12, is actually in our favor, because we get to develop it and create a road path to it. Well, with that, I'm very fortunate to be at Concordia Shanghai that I have very, very supportive administrators. Just like I mentioned earlier on, that my principal would say that, why not? Why aren't we doing it? On this slide here, we have some of the important things are supportive leadership, which my school does have a lot. Professional development that is relevant to personal and school goals. Well, most teachers would be sent or would want to attend professional developments that are related, directly related to education. However, when I pitch the idea to my administrators and say, I want to attend IBM Insight 2014-2015, Insight World of Watson 2016, I was given the green light. Nothing to do with K-12 education, so to say. But I needed to attend those conferences to be able to bring back ideas to the school and say, this is what industry needs. We as educators, we need to able to bounce ideas off among some of my colleagues there. Opportunities to alternate careers in the classroom, like mentor teaching. Again, with the support of my administrators, I'm able to deliver this course that is very different compared to how a typical established course that is being taught. So in our first year of teaching big data analytics in 2014, I applied the idea of paradigm shift in teaching. And what do I mean by that? I move away from sage on stage to guide on the side. So what it means is that traditionally it has been, teaching has been done where the teacher or the instructor stands in front and the students will be listening and taking notes. But with this shift in paradigm from stage on stage to guide on the side, me as the instructor, I'll move aside and I'll let the students lead. I know what my objectives are and I know where I want to get to, but I do not do the direct delivery of the material. I have the students to do it. So this is a picture of how the first year course was being done. So in our first year we had, actually I think there's someone who was missing over here too. We had about six students here. So as you can see here, we have a student who's actually doing the teaching for one of the chapters. And that student, William, was actually the one who actually presented at the Big Data AdCon in 2014. And the way it was being delivered was that we were doing a chapter verbatim. That's what Grace was saying. We have the students be the master of a chapter. So each of the students are being assigned a chapter, and they were given time to prepare notes and PowerPoint and to teach the rest of their peers as well. What are some of the requirements? How do we measure what is being learned? By a project. And I think someone mentioned this as well earlier on, that we give a project to a student, but it's got to be a project that the students has got interest in. And that's very important. Instead of us having a project in mind and it's because of what we want or what we are interested in, we shift it around and say, well, you come up with a project that you are passionate or interested in. And this is what I did with my students here. They are free to select a topic of their choice. And shown here are some of the projects that were done by the first group of students. The first one here is on how big data has shaped microcredit. Interestingly, this student was a 12th grader, a senior, and she actually has been running a microcredit organization when she was a 10th grader. Little did I know. And how did she do that? She was applying real life practical knowledge from her experience to this project. The fact that she was running this non-profit microcredit organization was that she actually went to the telephone company to ask for some of the bills and to look at at what times do this particular person tend to make phone calls. If the phone calls were random at any time of the day, it's hard to just to make anything out of it. But if the individual, if we know that an individual is a farmer, and that farmer only makes phone calls, or the bulk of the phone calls are during lunchtime or dinner time, that's a good sign. Which means that during, say from 8 to 11, that person is working, it's not on the phone, that's what we assume. And from say about 2 to 5 o'clock, that per individual is not on the phone. But the only time the individual is on the phone is during lunchtime or dinner time. That's a good indicator. The other one too is, does the individual pay his or her utility bills on time? If you're an individual who pays your utility bills on time, that means you are a responsible person. So if we were to lend you money, then it's very likely that you will repay us at a timely fashion. So this individual was able to apply this practical knowledge onto big data. The other one, on engineering. This is a survey on the engineering field, in the genders, the different disciplines in engineering, and salary scale, and the different locations in the US. And then we also have a student who did big data in healthcare as well, to look at where are the resources going and who are the people who are in need too. And then we have this student who does it on big data in particle physics. At our school, every year, we have a master's physics master's class that's run by our physics teacher who used to have his internship at CERN as well. It was interesting because yesterday during the click presentation, he was making a reference to the CERN collider about the book called Ozone. So our students actually participate in that as well. So these are some of the projects that have been done in the past. In our second year of teaching, delivering big data and analytics, we decided to add on project-based learning. And what does that mean? We have the students doing the project. In fact, Aaron and Grace, they are part of this project as well. I collaborated with our social studies teacher, history teacher, looking at some of the data on how and why did war start. Is it because of lack of resources, or is it because there's a greed in resources? So we had the students went through this compendium of data, looking out for the natural resources such as wheat, oil, grain, and so on and so forth, to see if there is actually some information in there that will indicate why the war break up. And in our second year, we had a data scientist from IBM Canada who visited us and was the keynote speaker to SysMoon, which is Model United Nation. So at our school, we actually run Model United Nation for high schoolers as well, internationally. And this conference was attended by about 800 students, and we pulled on the data scientist to give a talk on how big data is related to some of the global issues. And with the support of industry, IBM, we actually have got data scientists coming to our school to give workshops on how to use Data Studio, which is actually one of the software for big data analytics. That's on the education part, on what the students can get out of us. From an administrative point of view, how do we apply big data? Well, with the change in economic environment in China, we saw a drop in students' enrollment in international schools. But what does that drop mean? So my principal gave me some data for the past 5 to 10 years on all the international schools in China. We were looking at the trend to try to predict what the enrollment is going to be like this is what the target is going to be. He told me to give him three numbers, the good, the bad, and the ugly. So marketing actually met the numbers there. So this is one of the applications of how we actually apply big data from an administrative point of view as well. Something else too though. Our high school counselors are very interested in the students' well-being. We know our students work very hard. Sleep deprivation is usually one of the big issues. So what our counselors do is that on a weekly basis, we actually do a survey to our 9 to 12 students. We have about 7 to 8 questions that they have to answer, and some of which are, how much sleep do you have? And what is your well-being? Are you happy? Are you stressed? Are you depressed? And he picked these two, and he thought there may be some relationship, there may be some correlation between sleep and happiness, or well-being, or stress. Let's take a look at this data here. Hours of sleep, happiness. Basically, is you can interpret that as your positive well-being. And it's no surprise, well, the more sleep we have, we feel better. But how much sleep do we need? If we look at this data over here, it seems as though it will start to plateau at about 7 hours. So the counselors at our high school will encourage our students to try to get your sleep at least minimum of 7 hours. Why? Because let the data speak. The numbers tells us that you need about at least 7 hours of sleep to feel positive about yourself. So from a counseling point of view, this is very helpful. This is how we can further support our students on that. So that's the first 2 years. Comes the third year. We see that we can do more with this course. There were 4 things that were added to the current year in big data analytics at our school. Global collaboration, online courses, blended learning, or distance learning program, and curriculum expansion. And I'll go to each one of them. The global collaboration. Well, we did a location-based services project with Richard there on collecting the metadata that's taken from the phone. Because at our school, every year for 1 week, we have our students we have a student body of about 300 students in the high school. And this year we went to 17 different locations in China. And that was a really good opportunity to be collecting GPS data, metadata, location data on the pictures. MOOC courses, those online courses, we managed to bring in Big Data University IDEA Canada on board as well. This is an online These are online courses that are free that students can actually earn digital badges as well. Now, what are digital badges? Is anyone familiar with the digital badges here? Yeah? Okay. So what it is that universities, the admission offices at universities are beginning to look at digital badges or these MOOC courses that are taken by high schoolers. And why? Well, not every high school can afford to offer a huge variety of courses. Let's say if I've got a student who's interested in R or Python, but our school does not offer it, for example. But if there is an interest from the student will on his own initiative take these courses digital badges, well, education is something that we can never lose. So if the student earns a digital badge, they can actually put it on their social network, on LinkedIn and on their Facebook as well. So it's a permanent asset that they can gain. Nothing to lose, only something to gain in taking these MOOC courses. What are the courses that big data universities offer? Well, they have Big Data 101, Data Science 101, Hadoop, R, Deep Learning, Spark, Machine Learning, and Watson Analytics as well. So it was interesting that when Matthew Robinson was giving a workshop on Watson Analytics, and our students here, Aaron and Grace, are actually exposed to it already. And one of our parents as well. Last year when I was introducing this idea, I told them that you can actually teach yourself through these short courses. Each video is no more than 7 minutes long. IBM actually did a survey and found that for online courses, the attention span should be in that range. Anything more than that, you lose it. So they purposely designed these MOOC courses in very, very short videos. So as an example, Aaron learned Watson Analytics on his own through that course. Hunter David learned that on his own and able to produce a project on it. So it's not impossible that high schoolers can do it. And what Richard was saying earlier on, that do we really need to teach them how to use the software? Is that a good use of time in class? No. And as Grace mentioned, there's Sierra, there's edX, there's Big Data Universities. These are professionals, organizations that develop online courses. So why not make use of it? Why reinvent the wheel? So from a teaching point of view, I try to incorporate these MOOC courses into my class. I rather spend my time coaching them on how to utilize these tools to meet the objectives. Blended learning or distance learning. Because of the interest that other students from different schools have on big data analytics, we decided to pilot this program to our sister school, Concordia Hanoi, on it. So we offered it for the first time, an online course, what we call distance learning, blended learning, to on it. So the way this course was being delivered was that I flew down to Hanoi to meet the students and to brief them on what is the expectation on this course. And I think it's important for the instructor to meet the students at least once in person to develop the rapport and the relationship. And after that, we have regular Skype calls, regular Skype meetings, and emails. And in today's day and age, you could make use of Google Drive, you have Skype, so you don't really need to be there in person to deliver the material. So this is our first pilot course then with Concordia Hanoi. And shown here, without giving too much away, I have a student, Rio, the girl in the middle, is a Japanese. And she's interested in the earthquake activity in Japan. It's no surprise. So I encourage her to actually do a project that is of her interest and her passion. She managed to find a lot of data on seismic activity, earthquake activity that's related to Japan. And this is one of the infographics that she produced. This is probably going to be one of the student project presentation for the next EdCon conference. Now, when we talk about the curriculum expansion, that's where Grace's work came in. She helped develop the program last year on the material, and we actually implemented it and ran it for the first time in August 2016. So at that level, we had to tune it to a much easier level for our middle schoolers. Shown here are some survey questions that the students develop. What do I need to turn in? If I won $1 million, I would. What do you want to do with it? Teenagers, they love listening to music. What genre of music do you like to listen to? Then the demographic of our school. Why do they do this? Well, as we know, with data, garbage in, garbage out. This exercise was carried out for the students to understand and to appreciate how to collect good, quote-unquote, good data. How do we go about designing survey questions? Yes, there are a lot of data that's already out there, data.gov, Kaggle, and so on. But you need to understand the integrity and the reliability of the data as well. So this exercise here was carried out for the students to understand that. Well,
you can resume there, I think, isn't that?
Is there a resume button?
Yeah, just below you.
Oh, ah, there. Okay. This is a picture of how the big data analytics class was carried out for the middle school. As you can see here, students are working at it. They were given a project. At times, big data can be messy. So that's what's been happening for the past 3 years. Next year, we're going to be in our fourth year of delivering big data analytics. There are three things that I would like to implement. One is to bring in the Watson Analytics program. And two, to expand on our distance learning program. And this one is a personal passion of mine, to bring big data to the elementary school. Because 3 years ago when I first started this, I started it at high school. Then I had the idea of implementing big data to the middle school, which we have now. So my goal for next year is to bring big data analytics to the elementary school, to the little kids. Because it's actually those little ones that we need to invest in. As you know, in education, it takes time for things to cycle through. The younger the students are, the harder it is to actually introduce big data. Because we need to actually bring it to a much simpler form. So that's going to be our challenge next year, to try to develop a program for the elementary school students. So what's beyond this? That's a PS4 class, by the way. Those are the 4-year-olds. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. That was amazing. Just as an observation, were you there where one of the early BDA cons when we had that lady from Oceans of Data?
No, that was in 2013. That was
right.
The first one ever.
Have a look at that. There's some lovely stuff she's showing that will capture those little ones.
Yeah. Yes.
Question.
Very good question there, George. Over and over again, I keep hearing big data analysts, big data scientists doing analysis, coming up with an answer, and trying to make correlation to causation. And that's a huge, that is something that I keep telling my students, you got to be very careful about the interpretation of your data. Correlation does not mean causation. And this is the thing that I caution my students over and over again. Yes, you found the numbers. You found an insights to your data. But be very careful as to how you're going to be interpreting your results. My advice is to pass those analysis on to a person who is a subject matter expert then to do the interpretation. Because it's very dangerous for someone who is biased or who is not very well-versed in that subject matter to be doing that interpretation. So that's what I tell my students. That yes, you have found some numbers, you found some analytics to it, but your interpretation, you got to make sure that what you are saying is absolutely true, and make sure you consult with people who are subject matter expert in that area.
Yeah, so we have to have intuition enhancing methods.
Yes, that's the next part.
Sorry, Richard.
That's right. No.
In fact, one of the things that we are looking at doing is that, Bruce, what's the name of the course that Mr. Paulson is offering next term?
Mr. Paulson,
yeah.
Peace and conference?
No.
Conflict.
Peace and conflict? International relations or something? Yeah. So that was the one that I was talking about with my administrators as well, to try to have a part two to big data analytics, which is predictive analytics. And we're looking at how we can implement predictive analytics in that course.
Dinner.
Yeah, that sounds good. Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much.